go.
My goodness.
Oh, yeah.
Napier again.
There you go.
The kids from Kentucky are heading to the Sweet 16.
Boatwright.
Show me something.
There you go. Kentucky, how about that? The elation goes to the Huskies of Connecticut.
Kentucky takes a final spot.
You know, I dreamed about this day for a long time. I
always dreamt about this.
National championship, baby.
No one probably expected us to be here.
Everybody doubted us.
Nobody said we were going to be here, but here we are.
Finally, it's all paying off.
We get to prove that we can win a national title.
We don't need anybody else to believe in us. When we look each other in the eye, we already know.
This is UConn time.
We always believed that we were going to be here.
And now,
we're finally here. We made it.
Kentucky was making a run. Oh, my goodness, how did that happen? No look pass. Right on the money. Aaron Harrison. Oh, beyond belief. Spectacular performance by the Huskies. Kentucky has done it again. On to the championship game.
Let it shine.
Which team will shine tonight at AT&T Stadium? Let It Shine, sung by the inspiring Body of Christ Living Sound Choir from right here in Dallas. As we bring you inside, somewhere in the neighborhood of 80,000 will be on hand. 66 games played to get to this point, and two heavyweight programs left standing with the biggest title of all. National champion, will it be Kentucky or will it be Connecticut? Hello, friends. Jim Nance, Steve Kerr, Greg Anthony. Can't wait to call this one with my buddies. Who would have thought 3 weeks ago, Selection Sunday, brackets come out, all the speculation, who will make it to the championship game? We got a 7 and an 8 seed playing for the national title.
Yeah, we do. But guys, as you well know, this is not about Cinderella. And it's also not about the fact that these are two elite-level, tradition-driven programs. It's more about the fact that their talent has finally matured over the course of the tournament, and that's why they're both playing for the title.
Yeah, both clubs on a run. What's interesting to me, Greg, is how the two clubs enter this game. A little different manner, I think. UConn, a veteran club, methodical win over Florida. They're healthy and ready to go. Kentucky's got some injury issues and expended so much energy getting past Wisconsin, which was followed by a national championship-like celebration.
No kidding, and script seems the same every time. Aaron Harrison! Three straight games with a game winner, and this one the best of them all.
Look at the depth on this shot. Just the fifth three-point attempt all game coming from Kentucky. But Harrison, incredible heroics in this tournament.
Now, take a look at this. You may not have seen this footage. In the victory pile, number 22, Alex Poitras, a very valuable reserve and former starter, twisted his knee in that celebration. And you know, he said he's been in pain over the weekend since the game.
He's a critical performer for this team, particularly in this game. Remember, Willie Cauley-Stein is out with the injury. So Poitras and Cauley-Stein, the two most important pick-and-roll defenders on this team. And, Jim, they're going to see 1,000 pick-and-rolls between Boatwright and Napier tonight.
And one other thing to report. We just saw this in the warm-ups. You might remember on Saturday, Julius Randle rolled his right ankle. And he's been out here grimacing in pain. I met with him yesterday. That right foot last year, he broke it in the second game of his senior season and missed the whole season until the state championship game, which he came back for. That's the same foot. Let's shift it over now to the UConn Huskies. We all know about Napier. Sensational, All-America, but he's found some help in this NCAA tournament.
He really has. Shabazz Napier, his greatness is the reason why UConn's been good all season. But really, it's been about him finally getting a little help from his friends that's allowed this UConn team to have a chance to become great. DeAndre Daniels has just been lights out on that front line with providing balance from an offensive standpoint and toughness on the backboard. And nobody's been tougher than Ryan Boatwright. Defensively, as disruptive as any guard you're going to see in America, he very well may be the catalyst as to whether or not UConn cuts down the nets.
Well, Greg and Steve have been calling these two programs Blue Bloods, Kentucky and Connecticut, about to tangle for the national championship deep in the heart of Texas. Tonight for the Kentucky Wildcats. At forward, a freshman from Rochester Hills, Michigan. Number one, James Young. At guard, a freshman from Richmond, Texas. Number two, Aaron Harrison. At guard, a freshman from Richmond, Texas, number five, Andrew Harrison. At forward, a freshman from Dallas, Texas, number 30, Julius Randall. At center, a freshman from Brooklyn, New York, number 44, Dakari Johnson. They are the three-time national champions and are appearing in their fourth championship game in the last 15 years. Please welcome the Connecticut Huskies.
Here with all the strength I find, there's nothing I can't do.
Here's Daniels, and he's done it again. Wow, did the Huskies catch fire. Tonight for the UConn Huskies. At forward, a sophomore from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, number zero, Philip Nolan. At forward, a junior from Los Angeles, California, number two, DeAndre Daniels. At forward, a senior from Berlin, Germany, number five, Niels Giffey. At guard, a junior from Aurora, Illinois, number 11, Ryan Boatwright. At guard, a senior from Roxbury, Massachusetts, number 13, Shabazz Napier. And introducing the head coaches for Kentucky in his fifth season for the Wildcats, John Calipari. For UConn in his second season for the Huskies, Kevin Ollie. So, everything is all set now. Greatest night of the year in basketball is coming up.
Lot of sets. They basically are looking to play a lot of one-on-one basketball, so those two strengths will be going at each other.
Driving it inside right away for
strength. UConn is really long and rangy and athletic, but Kentucky can go right into the paint and into the bodies of the UConn defenders and have success.
But that's where the ability to pressure the basketball and not allow for those post-feed angles to be created.
There goes Daniels!
And Daniels.
Andrew Harrison drives in, and that was blocked. That was blocked by Nolan.
up ahead. Gafai takes it to the hole, and he scores.
And this is one concern if you're John Calipari.
Again, it was slashing to the basket at this end by Daniels.
And the speed and quickness of this UConn team has shown. I think they're a little quicker than Kentucky getting out in transition.
And UConn is not hitting the outside shot. They've had open looks.
Oh, my goodness.
Look at that steal. It's Napier to Boat Ryan and Poitras.
Did you see the misdemeanor committed there by Shabazz Napier? My goodness. And that's something that he and Boatwright do really well. And you see here the contest there by Dakari Johnson. Clearly a foul, but...
Well, that'll send Boatwright.
Welcome back to North Texas. Take a look at Shabazz Napier, folks. Good defensive guards. They time you, they count your dribbles, and they get a feel for your tendencies as a ball handler. And that play right there leads to the foul on Dakari Johnson. It will also at times make a ball handler more tentative because you know that a guy has the ability to pick your pocket.
So, Randall, you guys thought when he was out there for under 3 minutes, he was not looking 100%.
I thought he was struggling a little bit with his movement. And I think my initial impressions of this game, UConn is the much quicker team. They're getting a lot of looks that they can knock down. Kentucky's going to have to pick up its defense a little bit and try to stay in front of these guards.
A champion is going to be crowned tonight. And right after the game, get your official championship gear. Get locker room tees, hats, and more at the official championship store of the NCAA. NCAA.com/shop. And reserve role, 11 minutes overall of action against Wisconsin. Another freshman. And here's Poitras spinning and getting rejected by Brima, who just come in. Bounce pass, and the shot rattles home.
If there's a transition basket to be had, they're going to take it early. If not, they're going to run a lot of clock, and already the pressure bothering Harrison, a backcourt violation.
The other thing we've seen, guys, is that off of that block shot, another transition opportunity. Again, that's a concern for Kentucky.
Here comes Napier, hitting the three-point shot for the Huskies. Now, Napier falls to the floor, and so too does Marcus Lee.
Could be a block on Lee. I thought Napier was terrific the other day against Florida with his patience. Florida did a nice job containing him, and he never forced the issue. He just kept moving the ball like a senior does. This time he frees himself up for an easy two.
Not there. Boatwright and Huskies want to run with. They got the numbers, and they go to the trailer, who says, you know what, Marcus Lee's going to block it if I take it. And I'm going to go to the instead. Oh, he spun him around and took him to the other side. What a beautiful move by Ryan Boatwright. Kentucky's gone over 4 minutes without a field goal. And the Huskies have the early momentum in the national championship game.
We've seen it all tournament. Just get into the paint. Any kind of penetration, get to the rim and put the ball up there. And let your bigs go get it. There's a lot of ways you can cover it, but you've got to have execution and precision and experience. Kentucky has switched 1 through 5 all year just to make it simple. I'm not sure they have other schemes.
There's another steal, and that's the one we just talked about. The freshman who's come in, Sam. Wisconsin. Only 4 turnovers for the whole game. And inside. Out of it. Samuel makes it in with the left hand.
And the quickness of Napier to keep the ball alive. Remember, though, Jim, Wisconsin.
Backing in. Dakari Johnson and blocked up behind by Daniels. Misses the short shot and pulled away with aggression by Brima.
Length and activity, the key for this UConn front line defensively. They can't deal with the strength, but they can bother Kentucky's field goal attempts just by getting hands up.
Three-point shot, swish!
That's just a difficult matchup, guys, for James Young.
So he's not his usual force. And that's Boatwright. It's always the Huskies, it seems, with the quickest hands tonight. And Napier, that will count. Poitras swats it away after it comes off the glass and was baseline. Defies a good outside shooter. Steps in and fouled by Poitras in the act of shooting.
That's the other thing. It's it could almost be nightmares. Just think about it. You go zone, and typically a zone is to try to force non-decision makers to make decisions in terms of your frontline players. Gafai and Daniels are really good with the basketball at the high post.
They've run a little zone in the tournament. You guys saw some of it against Louisville. Not a whole lot. They'll show some 1-3-1, but this is a team that would rather stay man-to-man.
Christine and Frank are watching this right now on March Madness Live at 3:45 in the morning in their living room. They've hooked up the computer to their television. As blocked by him, but not a field goal. As Hawkins passes up the shot, here is Randle taking it inside, and he's shut down, and Napier again got the quick hands on it, and the ball's on the floor, leads to a tie-up, and it stays at the Wildcats' end.
With 1:50,
Daniels went down with two fouls. Things have changed. Napier, big step to the hole, twists the shot, and somehow able to contort and get the two. His second foul on the Randle basket. So, for the fifth NCAA tournament game in a row, Kentucky goes to the locker room either trailing or tied.
Down four after being down 15 at one point. Let's go over to Tracy.
Thanks a lot, Coach. You had a fast start there. Kentucky battle back. They're a second half team. So what do you need to get back to doing in the second half here?
Well, we're a second half team too. So whatever Kentucky is, we're going to go one step further. We got to play together. We had some turnovers. They start getting on the offensive rebounds. We got to stop penetration. They start getting into our yard. We want to protect that. I like our position, and we just got to play at a level five and finish this game off.
Thanks so much.
Level right now, Kentucky far more aggressive. They've got UConn on their heel.
And you can hear it, too, Greg. There's a foul on Harrison, but the crowd predominantly blue clad.
Welcome back, and Kentucky has rattled this UConn team. Take a look here. Ryan Boatwright not running the right set, and the senior, Shabazz Napier, telling him, hey, listen, let's get back into executing here, because in essence, they're playing to Kentucky's hands, and you know what? That's another reason why he didn't pull that trigger on that three, I believe, is because he understands the importance of them continuing to run their offense and to execute, because to start this half, Kentucky's come out with energy and fire and confidence, and that's why right now they're on the verge of being able to take the lead.
Kentucky's put them on their heels, and UConn's put themselves on their heels.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think some of these mistakes have been really self-inflicted by the Huskies.
So two shots coming for Napier. Mom Carmen. So Napier looking for a 17th point.
And you know, the other thing is
just not strong enough with the hands to finish. Boatwright sees that one coming, and he falls right on Harrison.
And that's probably the first aggressive defensive play we've seen from UConn's backcourt in quite some time.
Yeah.
And the 10th turnover for Kentucky. We talked about it, only four all game against Wisconsin, but a much different look.
It was
a layup. They were lucky.
It was a good call.
Was made. Yeah.
There's Boatwright. He lost it. Able to get it back. Huskies have not made a field goal in over 6 minutes, missing their last seven shots. Napier lobs it. Down low, Daniels. He'll finish. No. Taps it once and gets it to go.
Boy, that's a big bat.
Under 12. Timeout. Boatwright to Gafai, and there's a three-point shot by the senior from Berlin.
Coach Calipari can't believe it. He's yelling at Young. Kentucky went 2-3 zone for a different look. Gafai is a corner three-point shooter. Young too late.
Look at Boatwright. Boatwright with Harrison there. And Harrison is going to be called on the hammer, his second. So free throws coming out.
That's why Calipari was so animated with him and losing focus on a huge possession when Napier wasn't even on the floor.
And they keep Napier on the bench. Get a little bit more time for him to recover. He's gone almost the entire way.
This is more than likely his last rest.
Exactly.
So I think Kevin Ollie would like to get him maybe another minute or so, but no sense waiting around and messing around in this game. Napier's not a guy.
And Greg, you said this during the break. Kentucky may have blown an opportunity here. UConn was 3-for-13 to start this half, and yet the Wildcats have lost ground. Mm-hmm.
They haven't hit a shot in the last 4 minutes at this end. Randall, doubled up. That's into the first row.
That's all he wanted to get across, guys.
Well, they had valuable possessions when they had him on the bench. And here he takes the shot, coming back in and upping the lead to 9.
That was just great defense by Kentucky. Did a good job of being of holding containment, but also being disciplined to not overextend their help.
Wildcats can take the lead for the first time. Who else? Aaron Harrison, not this time. On the floor. That's Poitras taking it down with him. They say jump ball, UConn.
Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
Looked like Poitras got fouled there. Let's take a look.
He's got ball there.
You know what?
He is. You know, that's a. I know there's contact, but he's also got.
Boy, Kentucky's defense has been dramatically better since that opening barrage.
Napier. Wow. Right over Aaron Harrison. Napier now with 22. And again,
went over that play during shoot around and practice yesterday. But UConn did not recognize the action.
Here's Defy, top of the key. And they hit back-to-back threes.
And Randall down there.
Roma was in a jam, was able to get it out to Gafai, and now Boatwright looks up and realizes 5 to shoot. Over Randall.
Oh, my goodness.
Forget about that ankle.
And this is one thing. See if Kentucky's able to get back.
Yeah, put some pressure on the defense. And how about that play from Gafai? Yeah. Staying in front without fouling and then getting the rebound.
Lob it underneath to Daniels. Two Wildcats commit. Daniels
would be really important right now.
And you got to foul the right guy. Assuming UConn gets the ball in, which they do. If you foul Napier, it's going to be danger time. It looks like Kentucky is going to play this out.
Aaron Harrison looks over to his coach and able to knock it loose. A little helter-skelter for a moment. 15 to shoot. 30 left in the game. Underneath, wide open, and falling right on top of Troma.
Just a horrendous defensive possession for Kentucky. If you're not going to foul, then don't foul. And don't leave the guy wide open underneath. It was like a late double team that really wasn't necessary. It looked like Young just left his man.
And Steve, I really felt once he made the foul to call the timeout, you almost have to foul at that point, because remember, this is also a great free throw shooting team.
He's now 7 of 7 in the tournament.
It's a young team. That's one of the disadvantages to the inexperienced, because you got to make sure they know what you want to do. But boy, that's a critical decision by Calipari that may backfire.
And Poitras with his fourth foul. UConn 10 for 10 at the line.
No threes. If you're UConn, play the three-point line. Make this into a three-possession game, not a two-possession.
By Harrison, takes the shot, ball back out to Andrew for the three, and that one's off. Tapped into the hands of Boatwright with 5 seconds on this most improbable tournament run, comes to an end with a UConn championship. The Huskies once again are in basketball heaven. National championships for that remarkable young man right there, Shabazz Napier. And Kentucky denied the chance to set the mark as the youngest national championship team of all time. I was talking to Kevin Ollie yesterday. He knew that most people thought it was feeling like Kentucky's year, the outsiders. He said, my kids don't blink. You don't understand. We're tenacious. We're resilient. We're tough. That's the UConn way, the way I learned from my Hall of Fame mentor, Jim Calhoun. We're fighters. And that comes from the coach, Kevin Ollie, who carries the initials KO.
That's a great call. And also, a team will always take confidence when you feel like you have the best player on the floor. And Shabazz Napier was that tonight.
First number seven seed to ever win the national championship. Then almost lost in the very first game. Had to go to overtime to beat St. Joe's. What an unbelievable tournament it's been from the very start. A second ring for Napier. As well as Gaffey and Olander, who were on that 11 team. Kevin Ollie, you were 6-0 as a head coach in NCAA tournament play. You brought your alma mater to the promised land. The UConn Huskies are the 2014 national champions.
Pavilion in Storrs, Connecticut. And why not be happy? The new champions of college basketball on the men's side are the UConn Huskies. Up in moment. The champion UConn Huskies. Up next, the presentation of the 2014 National Championship Trophy. We'll be back with that and more as we continue live from North Texas on CBS. Texas, where the UConn Huskies are the kings of the basketball world. Let's take you now down to the court for the trophy presentation to the new national champions. Jim Nance is with the UConn Huskies. Jim.
All right, thank you, Greg Gumbel. And ladies and gentlemen, the UConn Huskies, the national champions. I'm here with the president of the NCAA, Dr. Mark Emmert, and the chair of the NCAA Division I Men's Basketball Committee, Ron Wellman, for the presentation of the National Championship Trophy to the Huskies and head coach Kevin Ollie.
Well, thank you, Jim. And first of all, congratulations to both the Kentucky Wildcats and UConn Huskies for the great tournament run that they had this year. Now, on behalf of the NCAA and the Division I Men's Basketball Tournament Committee, congratulations to Coach Kevin Ollie and the UConn Huskies as Mark Emmert presents the National Championship Trophy.
Wow.
That's me.
How do you put this one into words, Kevin? Coming out when, you know, you're a team that's a seven seed, you lose a game by 33 in March, you know, right before the tournament, and you gel and go all the way to the title.
Right. I said in the beginning, 18 months ago when we started this process, that the last is going to be the first. And now we was last, and now we first. But we always did it together. And they was one as a group, and it was great. Watch out, bro.
And then there's what you like to talk about, this UConn family and the UConn way of doing things. With all your entire basketball operations and staff, all UConn people.
My coaching staff, my players, all of us UConn, our family, all our alumni is here, and that's what it's all about. Coach Calhoun, the greatest coach ever, he paved the way, and we just walked through it. So I want to thank Coach, too.
Let me see if I can find Shabazz.
Where that trophy at, man?
Ryan. You want that trophy, but I thought with 9 minutes to go, we might not see you again. How did you manage to keep playing on?
Man, I got a lot of heart, man. I know my teammates is giving it they all, and we put in too much work all year for me to give up on the ankle sprain. This moment was too big.
Thank you, Ryan. Shabazz, bookend, national championships.
the dream comes true. You talked about you wanted this spot, your last game, to be the last game of the season with everything on the line. How do you describe this one?
Honestly, hey, I want to get everybody's attention right quick. If I can have your attention, if I don't have your attention, let me get your attention. Ladies and gentlemen, you're looking at the Hungry Huskies. This is what happens when you ban us. Last year, 2 years, we worked so hard for it. 2 years in Hungry. Hungry Huskies.
Shabazz, you've just been named the most outstanding player of the Final Four. Congratulations to the UConn Huskies. For the fourth time in 15 years, the trophy is heading back to Storrs, Connecticut, the national champions.
Tracy, thank you very much. And the Kentucky Wildcats, who never led in the championship game, fell by six. As you now take a look at the scene on the court, Werner Ladder proud to donate to the general scholarship fund of every school in this year's Final Four. Werner, the official ladder of the NCAA basketball championships. And Grant, I can only guess what it must be like to think about cutting down those nets once the season begins.
It's an amazing feeling, Greg. And for UConn, to go through what they went through this year, all the adversity, certainly turning it on and getting hot at the right moment, and to see the joy and the excitement from the fans, from the players, from Coach Kevin Ollie, to go up there and cut those nets with your teammates really just symbolizes, hey, we are the champions, we're number one, we're the best team. And it is the best feeling in all of sports and all of basketball when you get to that moment.
And the seeds for this moment were planted about 18, 20 months ago when Jim Calhoun decided to retire. Shabazz Napier was personally disappointed in Jim Calhoun for that decision. They were facing a postseason ban. Two of his teammates transferred. Kevin Ollie had to convince Shabazz Napier to stick with him and stick with the program. And I talked to Kevin Ollie a lot about this and his feelings for Jim Calhoun. He called Jim Calhoun an unrealistic thinker. You have to be an unrealistic thinker to have believed on March 8th, when UConn lost by 33 points to Louisville, that they could even possibly be on the court cutting down the nets. And it's that belief, it's that unrealistic thinking that Kevin Ollie brought to his NBA career, getting cut by nine different NBA teams, to holding his team together with that belief, and only they believed that they would be the last one standing tonight. It was an inspiring game. Kentucky played well. They go 13 for 24 from the free throw line. That was the difference in the close game. We have a worthy NCAA champion capping off what was just a great season and a tremendous tournament. My congratulations to both these teams, and especially the UConn.
Talk about a team of destiny. How about the fact that Kevin Ollie brought this team to AT&T Stadium earlier this year to show them where they could end up, where they could compete, where they could win a national championship. We'll be back to wrap it up with one shining moment right after this. Their school's fourth national championship, all of them since 1999. Our congratulations to head coach Kevin Ollie and his Huskies. We also applaud coach John Calipari and his Kentucky Wildcats, who enjoyed an outstanding season and an outstanding tournament. As we get set to say goodnight from Texas, all of us at CBS and Turner Sports, thank you for joining us. For all of us, I'm Greg Gumbel. We culminate our celebration, as always. Here is one shining moment.
Of an eye, that moment's
Has come to an end. Stephen F. Austin, first ever tournament win.
Feel the heat of your, feel the wind in your face. It's more than a contest. It's more than a.
Goodness! Stauskas. For the final four, Harrison. Oh, he made it!
And when it's done, win or lose, you always need your fans, cause inside you.
Oh, Daniels!
In one shining moment, you reach for the sky.
This is the point where he always hits it. Oh, Aaron Harrison, beyond belief. One more for the national championship deep in the heart of Texas. Swish. Back to back threes. The Huskies once again are in basketball heaven.